The following podcast is brought to you by the Jonas Podcasting Network, found exclusively at wrestlingwithjonas.com.
Welcome to the latest edition of the SWN podcast. I am your host, Billy, as always. And on this edition, I am joined by Logan Smith. How's it going?
Aye, not too bad. How are you?
I'm doing great. I've got four interviews left, and you're my rundown for interviews for this season. So I'm very excited to... I'm excited to do these interviews, but I'm also excited to get a break as well at the same time. Because I think this will be the 60th one I've done round about there. So it's not even been a year yet. Usually I would do like a big, like your moniker, but I didn't seem to have one. I had the Upstart, because you're in the Upstarts with Owen Jax. I don't know if you're cool with that for the future.
It's not really something that I've ever thought about being known as the Upstart, but aye, it was the team that I ran with Owen Jax for a while with, so aye.
So we'll be back. First question is always the same. How did you get into pro wrestling? What got you hooked?
I don't know, it was always on in my house. So like it was always sort of playing about the living room, but nobody really paid attention to it. I started paying attention when I seen the triple threat ladder match playing on the telly, and I was like, whoa, that's cool. I just seen these guys going absolutely AWOL doing whatever they wanted. And I was like, that's well cool. And that's what hooked me on, like, actually watching wrestling. But actually getting involved in wrestling came quite a few years later. When I started high school, and I went to, like, I didn't know Scottish wrestling was a thing until I got to a certain age. I didn't know Scottish wrestling was a thing until I met someone in high school and their brother, who is a wrestler. So I went to see his show. He goes by the name Manlin. So I seen Manlin. I went to Manlin's show, and straight away I was like, oh, that's well cool. I'm going to start doing this. So I went to school with Owen Jax as well. So I'd said to Owen Jax, because we used to play action figures as we guys. So I says to him, I'm going to start wrestling training. He's like, well, I've already started. And I was like, oh, that's well cool. Where can I go? And he gave me all the details. And from there on, it's been 6 years and I've not looked back. So,
The triple threat ladder match, was, I presume it was the Hardys, Edge, Christian Dudley's.
That's
fine. Just for your age, I'm thinking, that's a really early one. I was like, must be a replay.
What was the old show? WWE From the Vault. So it was that used to come on after something that was watched regularly in my house. So that would come on straight away, and then one day it was that, and that was the one that got me going.
So I've got another podcast guest that could blame Jeff Hardy for this journey that we've went on a little bit.
I mostly blame Edge. Edge was the one that got me more.
I always had that at school. It's like if your pal, me and my pal, we were Hardys. He was Matt because he wouldn't climb on stuff, and I was Jeff because I would. that was just how it was in general. So you started training a couple of years later after seeing a triple threat ladder match. What was it like that first? Because I know the school you were at, as is for a lot of people that I've spoken to from that school, it was Matt's. So it was a bit different going in, going, oh, I expect there to be a ring here.
Well, yeah, it was different. Like, obviously, you do expect to walk in and be like, oh, where's the wrestling thing? But I don't know, training on mats really taught, like, it taught you to use more common sense rather than trusting the ring for certain things. You became used to actually, dealing with just being on the mats instead of having, like, corner posts. So it let you deal with sort of more technical side of things rather than a more advanced level of things. So I don't know, it was good to start with, but then you get to the point where like I need to be in a ring to start actually learning how to use the ring. But eventually getting that experience, it was worth learning both sort of styles at different times, I suppose.
So what was your first thought, Dave? Do you have a bit of a athletic background? Do you do football, anything like that before you started training?
No, like I tried loads of different things, like on like when I was younger. So I tried like karate and everything. I tried basketball. I'd done basketball coaching for a couple of years. I tried free running and everything, honestly, but I would last about a month for every one of these and it would never stick. So I liked going to the gym and that. I liked going to the gym in my school, but I had nothing really to aim towards at that point. But then as soon as I started wrestling, I realised that, Jesus, this is quite physically demanding. You need to actually keep up with yourself here. So actually, I wouldn't say I was a completely athletic kid because I was quite chubby until I started wrestling, but it definitely helped realise that there was a lot to go.
So you started training, obviously doing the cardio. What was it like taking those first bumps? Was it a kind of reality check from that point?
Oh, they sucked. I took the first bumps and I was like, this isn't what I thought wrestling was. This isn't what I thought it was. It sucked. I was like, nah, I've had enough already after 1 week. But I was like, nah, I'll give it another couple of weeks, see how I feel. But nah, it was horrible taking the first few bumps. Well, when I started, it was the first few bumps on the crash mat. So it was okay taking them on the crash mat. And then when you done them well, they would take you over the mats and be like, try them on that. You take it on that, you go, oh, that doesn't feel like a crash mat at all. You just feel like they're absolutely... Yeah, I honestly felt as though I'd been in a car crash or something for the very first time. And I was like, oh. But it's one of the things you sort of get used to, I suppose.
I was going through the wonderful world of Cage Match to get like some research and things like that. So you made your debut at an Academy Attack show, as everyone does going through the school you were at. Yeah. What was it like going in front of a crowd for the first time? Or how did you find out you were getting your debut?
I don't know, we were all sort of sat around like... So we would always have our lunch break, and then after our lunch break, it would be a sort of rundown of what the following weeks are going to bring, like what's happening at the next shows, and what matches are going to take place during training today. And it was sort of at that time, it was like the show Academy Attack was starting to get planned, and it was just sort of like, oh, by the way, you're on this show, so tell me how many tickets you think you can sell for it. And it's like, well, hold on. I've only been wrestling for like a year. You start to panic, like, I don't know if I'm going to be ready for a crowd. I've never done it in front of a crowd that's not other wrestling trainees. But actually going into the show was quite settling, because you know that your friends and family were out there for your first couple of shows. They're out there supporting you no matter what. So at least that way you knew that there was some people out there that you knew, rather than a room full of strangers.
Especially if you're going out to get cheered, at least you've got a couple of folk there that will actually cheer you, and it'll ripple around the room. so were you quite an outgoing person, or was that... A lot of people I've been finding say that they're absolutely nervous as soon as they step out, though. They just turn to something else. Is that your experience?
I think it's the same for absolutely everybody. It's nerves just build up with you, and it's the sort of nerves of the unknown, like what is going to happen when I step through the door. But as soon as you step through the door and you realise this is all right, like, it settles you completely. But I think everybody's the same, like even people that I still talk to nowadays that are just debuting or have debuted for a new company, they go through and they're like, that wasn't as bad as I thought it was going to be.
And of course you teamed with Owen Jacks, now Jimmy Pierce, elsewhere. But so was that another comfort? I mean, you were nervous going into it, but was that comfort knowing that you were going in with someone that you grew up with
Absolutely. It was going out in my debut with three guys that I consider as like really close friends of mine. Three guys that I consider as really close friends. Obviously, I've known Owen Jack since we were like eight or something, and then Danny Weiss and Ray Barani as well. Trained with him for a couple of years before. I trained with him about 8 months or something before we actually debuted all together. So it really sort of settles you knowing that there's other people there that you can trust, knowing what you are all capable of going into the match.
It was, when I was doing that research, I realised that I probably saw you quite near the start then, because I did Rock and Wrestle with
Max,
and I'm in Elgin, so Inverness is pretty nearby. And from what I remember, I really enjoyed yourselves as a team, because it was high energy. Everyone, if you go to Inverness for a wrestling show, they don't see wrestling that often, so they're just well up for it anyway. But so when you were going out in front of an actual crowd, so a non-paying, a non-friends and family show, was it the same kind of feelings? Did you have any extra nerves? Did you struggle with getting the crowd involved at all?
My first time going in front of a crowd where I didn't know anybody was actually only came about 2 months after I done my debut. So about 2 months after I did the family and friends show, it was a different atmosphere, knowing that you don't know anybody out there, you don't know what sort of reaction you're going to get. I don't know how certain people react to things yet. I don't know the best way to portray what character I'm going out there to be. I'm trying to get booed at this point. So I'm going out there as this, what age was that? I was 16, 15-year-olds. I'm going out there as a 16, 15-year-old trying to get people to hate me. And it's just, it really goes, I don't know how do I get people to hate me so quickly? Because these people didn't know who I was. Nobody knew who I was at that point. Whereas the first show that I done, I've got my family and friends there that know who I am. They know what character I'm trying to be. But 2 months later, nobody knows in the world who I am. But it was definitely a different vibe than the debut. But again, it was the same thing going out there. As soon as you're out there, you get the reaction you look for. It settles you completely.
So what was it like getting to the ring then? Because, of course, it was treated as a privilege to get into the ring during setup shows or what have you, because you're training on mats. How different did you find it? Of course, running ropes being one thing, but how different did you find it getting into the ring for the first time?
It's a hard thing to explain, because as soon as you get in, you're like, you sort of go, this feels good, this feels right. Now I feel like I'm actually like properly wrestling, rather than, obviously the mats thing was a great sort of way to learn for me. But as soon as you get in the ring, you sort of feel like this is what wrestling should feel like. This is how I feel like wrestling looks like. Now I feel like an actual wrestler rather than a trainee. So actually getting in the ring, it made me feel like that's I've done something now. I've actually done something with myself that I can be proud of. But it does give you that sort of feeling of like, right, it's something serious that you're doing. Like, and obviously there's guys who do make their living off this point. There's still guys who are making a life's earnings wrestling, and you're trying to join them in this. So you do feel that way, where you need to be sort of keeping up with the way that they keep the ring and stuff.
Yeah, it's just a whole new learning experience. So again, did my research. I've got, you were 2 years in, we'll jump about a bit, but you're 2 years in and you had to take time off for a dislocated shoulder. Around about 2 years. When did you first know there was a problem?
I sort of knew straight away, but I didn't try to believe it. Like, I'd done a move and I sort of landed on my elbow wrong. And I felt pain, but I got up and I finished the training session. And actually, funnily enough, the day that I had done it, I'd planned to go to a trampoline park with my other friends. So we went to a trampoline park afterwards, and I had this feeling like I just had to crack my shoulder. That way you get it feel stiff and you think it just needs a crack. So I've got my pal pulling on my arm, trying to crack it, when in fact he was actually pulling all the tendons off my shoulder. So it was, I think 2 days later or something, I noticed it was starting to swell up and that, and it was just getting sorer and sorer. I went and they were like, you've fractured and dislocated your shoulder. And it slipped back in without you realising. I was like, right, well, that just sounds horrible to me. But it was sort of instantly I knew something was wrong.
If you land on your elbow then, that's obviously it's a bad injury, no doubt about it.
Yeah.
And it didn't help that you exacerbated it by trying to rip it off. But I'm just thinking, it could have been worse, because I know when I broke my elbow, I was told that if it was like any rotation, extra rotation, it could break your collarbone, it could break, uh-huh. it could break your neck, which, yeah. you know, when I was told that, it was a bit, that was a wake-up call. I mean, thankfully, I was still drunk, so it was all good. I laughed off. But yeah, it was just like, yeah, if you landed any extra rotation, you could have been a lot worse. I was like, oh, great, okay, cool. Thanks. Yeah, so that obviously went straight. You couldn't wrestle, of course, doing that. Yeah. And it's obviously something you've been doing for 2 years at that point. What were your initial thoughts on having to take that break?
Like, I was gutted. Like, this, it was the only thing that I'd ever like stuck to. So it annoyed me that I was being forced to not do it. But we were told, I was originally told that I would need to sit out for about 9 to 12 months. But I got about 6 months down the line, and I was told that no, I'm done. I was taking a seminar and training, and this was the last time. This was just like, this was 2 months or something before he went to WWE. So it was one of the last chances you would get to have a seminar with Noam. So I was like, do you know what? 6 months is long enough. I jumped back in, I have one training session, and I'm like, right, I'm good again. And then I go again next week, and the shoulder dislocates again. So I just, it was gutting to know that I've just got this reoccurring thing going wrong, and it just didn't seem like there was going to be a solution to that eventually. But I suppose it was just my fault at the end of the day, because I should have just took the 9 months that I was told to.
So in that 6 month period, though, what did you do? Was just rehabilitation? Did you watch wrestling, or was it something that you just went, no, I'm going to just take a clean break for, well, pardon the pun, but I'm going to take a clean break during that time?
No, I never, at that point, I never thought I'll take a clean break. I kept watching wrestling. I kept trying to see what can I do in wrestling when I come back, what moves can I do, blah, blah, blah. I was still going to training every week, setting lists, and then I was going to shows, helping me any way I can, setting up music, setting up the lights, whatever. but I was constantly, everything in my head was still like, I'm this close back to going to wrestling, I'm this close counting down the days on the calendar. But nah, wrestling never left my sort of mind in those 6 months, but I was still like, right, I like wrestling now, even though knowing that I couldn't at all. But that was still sort of gutting to know that you couldn't.
I spotted one picture that I think must be during this particular injury, that you did about ring announcing as well. So it was just, yeah. just trying to pick up any job you could to stay in about.
Yeah. That was awful to me, and it was something that I had to think about. I was like, I've never, at this point, I'd never spoken a microphone before. I was like, nah, I don't think I can do that. It's not something I'm confident with doing. But I tried it out in training a couple of times. It was like, you're doing fine. So actually going out and doing it in front of a crowd was a lot different, though. So I didn't need to give fair play to Simon Cassidy and a lot of ring announcers that do it every show, because it's a difficult job to do. It's you sweat constantly when you're doing it. You're just right in the spot centre of the stage. It's horrible, but these guys do incredibly.
Oh no, it's like, well, I did it once for one match, and that was it. I don't know how Simon and that keep all the weights and places that they're from and all their accomplishments all in one go. I was like, no, I would need to have like a wee cheat sheet and then just go and then cheat sheet.
I'm writing on my hand and stuff, trying to remember where people are from, and I'm like, oh, I can't do this. I'm rubbing them off between matches and writing them down in the other hand. It's
just sweating off as it goes.
I'm like, that's it. I need it. It's a dripping down my arm.
So you came back. I didn't take note of what your comeback match was, but not long afterwards, that's what it had been, 2017-ish, you had your first injury, you came back, and then you broke your leg.
Yeah.
Again, was this a training injury or trampoline park? Yeah.
Not training injury. So I had the day before that I'd done that, I had been wrestling again for about maybe 5-6 months after my shoulder surgery and everything got sorted, my shoulder was 100% again. I'd wrestled for about 6 months. The day before I'd done it, I wrestled Craig Tara against BT Gunn, and I felt like, oh, things are getting better, man. Things are going really good right now. The next day, it's Stevie Xavier seminar. I try to kick somebody. I swing my leg the wrong way. My shin hits their shin. Their shin was a lot stronger than mine. And mine just snapped.
Christ. Wow.
It wasn't that bad when the first done it. It just felt like it banged my shin. And it felt like it had bruised or something. So I tried to stand up. And knowing that I couldn't stand up, I sort of crumbled back down to the ground. So at that point, I was like, right, I've done something bad this time. So I went straight to the hospital, and I was like, I was due to go on holiday 2 days later. I got there and they set my leg in a cast, and I was like, right, cool. I go on holiday on Wednesday, is that cool? And they're like, no, you don't. I was like, cracking, cheers, thank you.
What is it with yourself and for those that are unaware, your sister is Rose Knight. What is it with you two at breaking things? Because who's around the family?
Honestly, we're just made of glass, apparently. It's ridiculous.
So she got into it after seeing you wrestle and thought, I can do that. Yeah. So what was it like having your sister on board with coming to training and make it part of the family?
I mean, it was cool. It was cool seeing, like, in a way that I thought I encouraged her to actually try it out. Her seeing me and then deciding that it's something she'd maybe enjoy. It was cool knowing that I had encouraged her to actually do something like that, because at that point she hadn't been doing much. If I remember right, she might battle me after hearing this, and I'm saying she was just being lazy. But she wasn't doing much at the point, and then went, that could be something that I would like. Started training, it was at the point, it was cool. Honestly, it was different to see her in that environment as well as like taking on the role that I had.
So you got to kind of do a little bit of training yourself and being able to kind of pass on any little tips that you'd, because you were a couple months ahead, of course, year or so ahead of her. And of course, your partner is Angel Hayes. So there's a big, I mean, between you starting because of you're Manlon's brother, and then, so Manlon, it's not Manlon, I keep saying it how it's spelled, Manlon's brother, and then you were friends with Owen Jacks, who of course was cousins with Luke King Sharp. It's like a whole, there's a very small world that seems to be in there. Yeah. So again, was Angel, I can't remember if I asked her at the time, but was that, you know, at training or was that you both started at the same time? What was, I don't need to know your relationship status, it's just training with your girlfriend being a wrestler kind of thing.
Yeah, no, I think she started training a couple months after me. I started in like September odds, she started in January, I think, so a couple of months apart, and that's when I sort of met her, and it was like, I don't know, maybe there was like a couple of months in between, and after a couple of months, I think it was like 5 or so months, I was like, we just started talking to each other, and we became friends and everything first, and then on in, it's been,
that's fine. We'll move on. I'm feeling awkward as it is speaking about that. So we'll speak about wrestling. That's more, way more fun. So in 2017, you end up in Denmark.
Yeah.
For Copenhagen Championship Wrestling. How did that come about, and what was your experience like?
Obviously, like I was good pals with Owen Jacks, or Jimmy Pierce as he goes by now. And as you say, these cousins, Luke and Sharp. Lou was taking a training camp over in Denmark. He was the head coach for the training camp. He spoke to a couple of us and was like, if you can get yourselves over, we'll train you for a week. You pay for the training, you train for a week. There's a possibility of a show at the end for yous. So we go there, we train for a whole week, and it was like 7 days. We trained for 6 days, and we trained about 6 hours a day. So about 36 hours in the week we trained for wrestling. And then at the end, as I say, there was two shows. So that's pretty much how it all came about. And I ended up having 3 matches over there. And I think during one of the matches, one of my matches with the Copenhagen Hangman, it was unfortunate because I was really looking forward to the match, but about 3 minutes in, my shoulder dislocates and I need to call the match. I'm like, right, can't do it anymore. But it was still a great experience to actually be invited over and be able to compete for the company.
And of course, you ended up doing a bit of travelling, especially around about the country. Of course, did Belladrum, which...
Yeah.
I've never actually been to the Belladrum shows, just because...
Oh, like, you're missing out. You're missing out.
Oh, I mean, I've always wanted to, and then every time I think, oh, I kind of want to go, and then I look and it's sold out. I'm just always too slow to go. Mainly because I think my wife loves Jack Chester. So the fact that she could see him possibly starting a boot in a field would be hilarious for her. Not in a weird way, but just like going, oh, Jack Chester. So what was it like wrestling at a festival then? Like Belladrum, you get to go see the music afterwards. What was it like?
Oh, it was a completely different atmosphere. Like obviously, we used to wrestling crowds and crowds knowing everything about wrestling. Knowing a bit about wrestling, like they've paid specifically to see wrestling, but these guys have bought tickets to a music festival and they just get the wrestling added in. They're just getting things like the wrestling, and we are like right after the singing kettle, so all the bands have loved the singing kettle, they're all buzzing for the singing kettle, and then we come out and we're like wrestling. But it was so different. It's just that atmosphere of walking out into a tent and you're like, oh, we're wrestling now. But everybody, like, you would just think you're at a wrestling show. Like, everybody reacted the way you want them to react. It was, and then actually just knowing that you get to go have a good time after. It's not a long drive back to the unit to put the ring away, then back home. You get to pack the ring in a van for tomorrow, and then you get to go out and have a nice time. You get to go and watch some bands. I actually got to see one of my favourite bands for the first time at Belladrum, Twin Atlantic. They had played at Belladrum. I think they played Belladrum pretty much every year, but that was the first time I had ever got to see them, and it was so cool. And I'm standing in this VIP area because I've got this artist wristband because I've just wrestled like 20 minutes ago, so it's cool. It's a completely different vibe to everything else that I've done, I think.
I suppose it would be a little bit of a dip into, unfortunately, your ICW run has mainly been to no crowd, but it gives you a bit of a taster of a bit of a more liquored up, high energy crowd for you. But no, I love seeing the photos because it's like everyone's sat on hay bales, and the place looks stinking, but it looks amazing.
That is horrible. It's horrible because you like I remember when you I can't remember who it was. But they've put their gear on, they've went to put their boots on, but it's ridiculous, the mud just outside the tent most years, because there's like a wee shoe cleaning area, but it's just like small showers, so all that shower water just like sprays and it makes all the mud just damp. So we are walking about with our wrestling gear on, but a pair of welly boots as well, instead of wrestling boots. So we've got our gear and welly boots on, walking around this campsite, and it just looks ridiculous seeing us walking about like that. But it's different with the guys that are just there with their kids or their wives, with a drink in them, loving it. It's cracking.
Well, the weird thing is that you wouldn't even look at a place, I'm assuming, because there's often folk that are dressed up in a lot weirder ways than just a pair of tights and some wellies. But no, I'm always fascinated. Hopefully, if Belladrum ever returns, just because you know the time it is, determined to get to one. I hate camping. That's the only thing. That's the only thing that puts me off it. If I could get away, if there's a package, we can stay at a hotel or something, and then go the next day. I'll do that. But no,
the camping throws me off. I think 1 year I made an attempt to try and sleep in a car. At this point, I didn't drive, so I tried to sleep in one of the other guys' cars. But he was sleeping in the car, so I was like, it's not for me to share a car with you sleeping, so I'll all just go into my tent.
That's the idea of health. Because I did one festival, and I was in the, I moved to the family friendly bit the day after because I was in with everyone else, and I had a tent kicked in. It's just an awful experience. Anyway, let's pick up because it seems to be I start a really fun conversation and then drag it down to something really weird. I was going through my research, pretty much just stalking your Facebook fan page to get information. And you did things like All Star Wrestling, the Craig Tara, Mega Slam. Yeah. So these are more intense shows because you do more than one show a day, but it's in front of like non-wrestling fans. How was that as an experience for you?
I'm like every other sort of different style of wrestling show, it's different. It's a different atmosphere that you go in. Like you're waiting backstage for these shows in Craig Tara, and you're waiting on a ring announcement. But what you're getting is these fun stars, as they're called, doing their whole shtick, trying to get the kids laughing and entertained. While you're wrestling, you're used to just hearing the crowd, but then when you're wrestling at Craig Tara or something, you've got these fun stars on the mic behind you with the louder you scream, the stronger he gets and everything. You're like, well, when they are shouting. Yeah, so it is a completely different feeling that you go into. But there's a bit more pressure on it as well because you've got your assertive time slot with places like Craig Tara and stuff. So you've got like maybe 3 hours to get in, get the ring up, get the matches done, get the ring down and get out. So there's a lot less time than a normal show. Because with a normal show, we maybe get 2 hours to set up the ring, we've got an hour to mess about, we've got an hour to get food, and then we've got an hour before the show starts. So we've normally got quite a lot of time, and then we squeeze into Craig Tara, and we've got like 2 hours to get everything done. So it does add that wee bit of pressure, but the crowds are always amazing at any of the holiday parks. They always just seem to be loving the wrestling, but despite them not being there for wrestling particularly.
I suppose if you're, in one sense then, it's a bit more pressure because you have to get in and out as quickly as possible, but at least then you're not expected to do Canadian Destroyers and flips and all that kind of stuff. It's a bit of an easier shift in that respect.
Yeah. Definitely.
So we'll get to just what you're doing now. Well, not right now, possibly, I don't know, because time it is, it could be open for doing more tapings. But you made your WWE Network debut last year.
On
Fight Club, of course, in front of nobody, no fans. How did that come about? And again, did you have any reservations of wrestling in front of nobody, or was it just a case of the opportunity?
At the point, like before I even knew that I was going to be on the tapings, I was at the point, I was like, I just want wrestling back. Like, I just want to wrestle. I don't care if it's in front of nobody. I didn't know that the tapings were going to go ahead. I didn't know they were a thing at this point. I hadn't been informed about them. But I was working on site, and I got a message through Twitter from Scott Reed, and he was like, oh, we're going to do tapings in the asylum. In front of nobody but for the WWE Network, so are you free to do them? And I was like, oh yeah, sure, cool, aye, sounds good to me, when you want me. He's like, tomorrow, and I'm like, right, hold on, right, I've not wrestled in 8 months and you want me to wrestle tomorrow? So I was like, oh, I don't know if I'm ready to wrestle, but again, it was the same thing. Obviously, going in and seeing this sort of setup that they had with the ring and the two entranceways, but knowing that there was no crowd there, it was like, man, that looks different. It's that sort of weird feeling that you don't like, where you feel like something's going to go wrong straight away, but you hope it doesn't. But sort of standing backstage, and I was backstage, I don't know if you remember, when it first came back, Simon Cassidy done the announcement with the whole, Willie, you're watching as part of the ICW Mafia, the WWE Universe. So I'm standing backstage at that point, and I had let it slip from my mind at this point that this is going live on like WWE Network and everything. I'd let it slip my head because it wasn't my main focus. But as soon as you said that, I was like, oh no, I'm not ready. But again, it was as soon as I went out there, I wrestled Theodorus in my first match, and he's a cracking guy to wrestle, honestly. He's talented, man. He's cracking in that ring. He's definitely something I want to wrestle again anyway. But going in there with him and knowing that I'd given a good match with him, it was that sort of feeling of relief that I had, that's me done it. That's me done my first one. So the rest should come easy. But again, it was that different vibe.
We'd have had to learn that you're not working in front of, you're not working for a crowd, you're working for a camera with a crowd.
Yeah.
Of a potential couple million, just to add that pressure on behind it as well. Did you seek out any advice from anyone before you did the show itself? Yeah, or
I'd spoke to guys that have obviously been on ICW, even with the crowds. Like, I spoke to Angel, who's done ICW with the crowds and done the fight clubs before. I spoke to guys like Lou and Krieger. They helped quite a bit with like what I can go through and do. And then obviously when I get there, Mark Dallas and Scott Reed, Jack Jester and that, they offered up their advice as well to Ollie, as knowing that this was the very first time they had done the tapings. So they had offered up their advice of what they know that they were looking for. So overall, everybody was like sort of really helpful, and straight away you just knew that they wanted what was best for us, but what was best for the product as well. So it was that sort of sense of relief that there were so many people there to actually sit there and help you rather than just send you on your way and hope for the best.
And when the show came out, the first one that you're on, were you, was it gather round or was it just a case of studying it? But have you actually watched it back? I should ask first.
I watched it back, but I'm still a teenager, so I'm still like, well, I was still a teenager at the time, but I was like, hey, I'm on the WWE Network, this is cool, this is real cool, look at me. But it was that way where I'm like, right, hopefully this happens more often. And obviously, after I'd done that first taping, I was told, we'll bring it back, we'll bring you back next week or the next so weeks. So at that point, I'm like, right, hold on, actually, I'm going to rewatch this and see what I can fix for next time. Did I work to the camera enough? Did I work to the right cameras? Because obviously before this, I was used to doing the family and friends shows or the family friendly shows where it was just a crowd, there was no camera. I had never worked to a camera before that. So I suppose it's sort of beneficial in a way, because what I've done is just replaced the crowds with a camera. Obviously, I don't start clapping towards cameras hoping it claps back. But it's just replacing the crowds with the camera, trying to get a reaction through the camera rather than through somebody watching me. But I think it's sort of beneficial because now I've had experience of working them both individually. So I've worked crowds individually, I've worked cameras individually. So hopefully when crowds come back, and hopefully I'm still on the Fight Club tapings and ICW when they're back in the garage or whatever, hopefully it comes sort of second nature to work both to the camera and the crowd. So I'm looking forward to hopefully being back.
That's when you're saying that about you're not clapping, expecting to clap back. It's still, I've watched the majority of them. I think I've missed a couple just because time. I know I'm working from home. I should have all the time in the world, but somehow because of these podcasts, I have none at the moment. But it always makes me laugh, and I know that it's not a wrestler's fault, but they pause during promos for a reaction. And I know it's just I know it's just timing. I know it's just them going in their head, the pause and everything. But I'm looking at it going, nobody's cheering back. I don't. Come on, there's 2 hours here. Come on.
Like moving, you look up and you're like that to the crowd and go, oh, right, well, there's nobody there. Nobody cares that I've just done that.
But it's certainly an experience to watch. I can only imagine how it is. Actually doing it, especially, is there a little less pressure because you can go back and tidy things up if needs be.
I think there is that sort of wee bit of less pressure where you can, you realise that you've got that opportunity to do it, although we tend not to like to do it. So we'd rather just do the match and be finished rather than go, right, we'll go back to the start, we'll film this again, we'll film that again. Whereas we'd rather just do it as one shoot as though we're doing it in front of a crowd. We'd much rather just act as though we're doing it in front of a crowd. But as you say, it's sort of uneasy to watch it. But I think it's a lot better watching it because you've got guys like Billy Cuckland and JRK, they're still talking and still going through. It's a lot different when you're in there and you've not got JRK and Billy Cuckland sitting there doing the run-through commentary while you're wrestling. It's just dead silence and it's just you two wrestling the ref. Like, watching it back and actually hearing JRK and Billy, you're like, I wish they were just there while you're wrestling because it's just different.
Yeah, I mean, it'll be a little bit different than the camps when you've got someone going, oh, cheer, hurry up. They'll be just sitting there just shouting, going, I don't know. I don't think anything that Billy says I can actually say out loud on here. So I'll move on. So let's go back through matches that you've had. Your return match from your broken leg was, if I'm right in thinking, it was against Jack Chester. Or was that your shoulder?
It was one. No, I think I had one match before Jack Chester. I think I had a triple threat with TJ Rage and somebody else, and I can't quite remember, I'm going to be honest. But,
Pro Wrestling Innovation, was it?
Big Massive Wrestling, it was.
Big Massive one. I mixed up the three of them.
That would have been my first one back, and then the second one after that was Jack Jester and his open challenge at Lambert. So, yeah, that...
How did you feel to get back in the ring after that? Was there a bit of a bit testing? Were you pulling back kicks just to make sure nothing would happen again?
I was still making sure that, like, everything I was doing, I wasn't going to, like, pure strain my legs. So, like, during the time, I was like, I'll buy kick pads and everything. So I bought kick pads and I was like, I never wrestled with kick pads before I broke my leg. And then when I broke my leg, I was like, I'll get kick pads, I'll protect it a wee bit. So coming back, I was still like, I can't do this. I can't do that move because I kicked with my left leg. Can't do that because I land on my left leg. So it sort of changed my style of wrestling slightly, but I was still making sure, like, I was still the same sort of wrestler. But during that time, again, all I'd done was lie in the house and watch wrestling and, like, learn different moves that I could do that I could avoid injuring myself and my leg anymore. But it was definitely a sort of different feeling going in and being like, right, I need to be careful this time because I get so used to being the fact when I was like, I don't care what I'm going out there to do. Like, as long as I'm wrestling and having fun, I'm happy to do whatever. Whereas this time I had to be like, right, I need to be careful what I do here.
You went from, I'm young, I'll bounce, to, no, I'm a winner.
Yeah.
Where was I going with that? Back with ICW, you're regularly tagging with Alex Parker. I suppose tumultuous relationship. That's not even the word I'm going for, but it's... an issue to each other. That's the kind of way I'm going with that. Again, it's someone that you probably were trained up with, I'm guessing, yeah. Alex Parker. Yeah. So again, was that another just a easy match because you've trained with each other?
Me and Alex, well, used to each other now. Like, honestly, I couldn't tell you how long you've been training right now. But I've known him for however long he's been training. And I get used to his style of wrestling. I'd tagged with him before on shows before we were on ICW together. But when we sort of got on ICW together, we realised, obviously when we started tagging, we had one tag match where we were against Theodorus and Charlie Weiss. And we were like, we were sort of not used to each other working as a tag team. We were used to each other wrestling each other, but working as a tag team, it was a different sort of... a different sort of feeling to it, like, where you were like, you're not used to actually wrestling as a tag team. because obviously I had wrestled with Owen Jacks for a couple of years before that, but then 2 years I was wrestling myself. I don't think I'd done many tag matches in between. So going back into doing like a sort of tag team wrestling style, it was different. But a few weeks later, we're starting to do things again. We were doing tag moves, and we've ended up doing like 2-on-1 stuff to Leighton Buzzard and a triple threat. And then it sort of builds up to us having a match with Lucan Sharp and Cragen and beating them. So it was different. But I started to like the way we work as a tag team. I just feel like we're connecting a lot better nowadays to actually experience being a tag team in this sort of different environment in front of no crowd and this new sort of promotion that we've never been used to.
And then go back to, say, you spent all your time either in lockdown or injured watching wrestling. Has there been any particular wrestlers that you watch to pick up a sort of style, or is there a particular promotion? What's been your kind of watch list?
There was nothing in particular, to be honest. Like, I was constantly just watching any wrestling that I could find. I'd go on YouTube and type in like high-flying wrestling moves or whatever, and there's like top 20 lists or top 50 lists. I'm watching them, and then I'm seeing a certain, like, I started seeing things through, like, Daniel Bryan from when he was, like, in New Japan or whatever he was, wherever he was in Japan and stuff. I'm going back, and I'm like, I'll go watch that match, I'll go watch this match. So, going from watching, like the Motor City Machine Guns doing their tag team stuff, and these top 10 lists, and then going and watching, like, full matches that they've done, and going, right, that's cool, I could do that myself, and do that move, and do that move. So, it was, a lot of it was just picking up random sort of, random clips off YouTube, and being like, I'll go watch that full match, and see that full match. So, actually going back and watching the matches probably helped me in the long run to come up with this new sort of style of wrestling.
Yeah, it's kind of like there is a bit of high flying in there, but it's quite a lot of just high intensity. A lot of running.
Yeah.
Really. So go back to like your favourite wrestlers growing up. You did mention the Edge being one of them. Was there any others that be it one of the big names or maybe some of the more obscure names in history that you kept an eye on and enjoyed watching?
Actually, growing up, I didn't really know any other promotion other than WWE. I didn't know any other thing. I knew I had been to a couple of All-Star Wrestling shows when I was younger, but I just thought that was Americans coming over and doing wrestling. I didn't know at the point. It was guys like there was Drew Galloway kicking about at that time and All-Star. Guys like Chris Travis and all that, he was still wrestling on the camps and Butlins and stuff, so I had been them, but there was never really any obscure names that I sort of looked up to because it was all WWE for me. So it was guys like Edge, Jericho, Shawn Michaels, Taker, Randy Orton, guys like that. It was all the sort of like guys from 2000 onwards that I really watched that sort of had their runs in that era. So it was guys like that that I was like these guys are like superheroes to me. So you'd watch it and it was all guys like Rey Mysterio and stuff. All the sort of weird guys, because like I said, I was like small at the time, but it was always guys like that. It was never random people.
It must be a bit mind blowing now, looking back at it, thinking that you saw Drew at an All Star show on a camp, and now he's like one of the biggest names in the world.
Oh, it's insane! It's mental. I actually found a picture not long ago of me meeting Drew at the All Star Wrestling camp. And just seeing the size difference between me and him was ridiculous. Like, it's so funny just to look at the photo and go, that's crazy. He's a 2-time WWE champion now.
It is just unbelievable. First time I met him was after his first run, but still, it's like, how are you from, how are you from Scotland? Because... Hi. No, I mean, everyone rags on his accent. That's not what I'm going for. Look at the size of him. That's just right.
You don't see many guys what about Scotland with big, long, flowing hair and, like, built like a brick wall in 6 foot.
I know they're not about quite often, but yeah, it's just absolutely mind blowing. And seeing guys like a Nicky Storm, is that who possibly would come through your way? Kaylee Ray, of course. It's just Scotland's doing all right, I think, for wrestling. Doing okay. So as far as like traveling again, you did a bit of work up further north than I am for Combat League. Where you were, well, your team Stag, I think technically you've won season one of their Combat League.
Oh, we did. We were undefeated the whole season. The only ones to get points on the board, so I'm taking it as a huge victory.
So what's like travelling all the way up? Because that's a fair journey to go all the way up to Caithness or Wick, who would have been for the shows if there was a Wick. So the game was just pile to the car games.
You dread it. You dread you sort of the night before. You're like, I've got 6 hour cars on me tomorrow. I really don't want to do it. Sitting in a car. But as soon as you're in a car with your pals and you just start talking, it honestly feels like you're in a car about an hour. And it's just sitting there playing daft games, like you say, that is, it's stupid games you sit and play. You stick on the music, you have a wee sing song between all you are singing old WWE theme songs, five grown men singing the sexy boy Shawn Michaels. But it is that sort of, it does pass the time so much easier than just sitting there all quiet and not actually communicating with each other, because I think I've done a couple of drives like that where it's been 3 hour drives and it's felt like 9 hours, whereas going up to Thurso it was like a 6 hour drive and felt like an hour. So it is, if you're with your pals and you know how to have fun with each other, then it is a great sort of drive, but you still enjoy the sort of the view you get as you're driving up, because like obviously you know yourself, driving up there is beautiful, the view you get, like the view is incredible driving up, but you still enjoy the time that you get to spend with your pals, but you enjoy the fact that you're wrestling that night and everything.
And the crowd up there, from what I've heard and seen, they're just, well, they don't get wrestling that often, so they're just buzzing for just wrestling.
I think the first time I went up, I had went up just to, there was a space free in the car, and I was like, I'd like to see one of these shows, I'd like to experience them, so I had no intention of actual wrestling on it. I took my gear and everything just in case.
Of course.
But I show up to the show, and the promoter was like, if you've got your gear, we'll find a spot for you. And I'm like, cool, nice one. So I'm trying to get used to this crowd. I'm watching on the cameras backstage and I'm listening to them, and I'm doing this sort of segment with Robbie Wishart, who's just had his match, and at this time he's probably one of their main heels, well, he was supposed to be anyway, but he was supposed to be one of their heels. He cut a promo, and I don't know what happened during his promo, but everybody just started loving him halfway through it. So halfway through the promo, everybody's cheering him. I'm supposed to come out and be the good guy, and I'm supposed to be coming out and be like, I'm the hero, I'll challenge you the next time we're up here. But I walk out, as soon as I walk out, all I hear is about four boys go, he looks like a wee sunflower. And instantly I go, right, I'm a bad guy then. Okay. So it goes, honestly, it was a completely different reaction. It was probably the best reaction I think I've ever had in wrestling, even though it was such a negative one. But I walk out there and all I hear is, he looks like a sunflower. I've never been called a sunflower in my life. And honestly, it was one of the newest things. It was mad to hear somebody call you a sunflower. But instantly, I turned into this bad guy. And like, honestly, I was out there for about 30 seconds, maybe a minute. And the reaction that I got from it was like, Jesus, man, guys that have known me for 5 years wouldn't care this much. But I, as you said, they don't get wrestling much, so any wrestling they get is like something amazing to them. So it is, the crowd's always chatting up there.
I'm just baffled by the insult. It's just sunflower.
I've never been called a sunflower. I didn't get it. I was like, I literally went back and I turned around and looked at the S in that and I went, ah, how'd I look like a sunflower? And I'm like, I can tell you, mate. I'm like, a sunflower.
So that's your name when you go back up then, the Sunflower Logan Smith.
Sunflower Logan Smith, I like that.
All right, so we'll move on to the fan questions before we do our my stupid dual questions here. We've got Jason Hyde. He just put to ask you what you and him would be called as a tag team.
Oh, I think we had a joke years ago. I think we were calling ourselves like Abs and Kebabs. But I think the whole joke in it was that he was Abs and I was Kebabs. That was the joke there. Honestly, like, Jason was, I think I only met Jason, like, at a PWS show, like, for the first time, and I sat down and spoke to him for about half an hour, and I don't know why, and I can't remember how it came about, but we ended up laughing for about 20 minutes about Turkey Drummers. I don't know if you remember, I don't know, I honestly couldn't tell you where that came from, but we were laughing about it for, like, 20 minutes or something, but... Abs and Kebabs was the name he is, because I was Cat Kebabs and he was Abs, but it was just a dark joke.
From experience, for speaking to Jason, I've never met him face to face. I've never seen him wrestle face to face, but I've spoken to him on podcasts. I'm just like, it'll be an hour will pass and I'll go, I have no idea what we spoke about for the last hour, but time has gone by. And I don't know what's happened, but oh well. So Abs and Kebabs against Pattern and Batter, and that's the future. Ian Skinner asks, he just asks how your throat is.
How my throat is, right? So I done Ian Skinner's debut with him. So Ian Skinner was having his debut match, and like we'd got through the start and everything perfectly fine, and then it gets to the point where he's breaking me down and he cuts me off. He cuts me off and I'm lying on my back and he goes to stomp me in the chest, but he misplaces his foot and just stomps me right in the throat. So he stomps me right in the throat and I roll out the ring and I can't breathe. I'm like, Sean McLaughlin's like, you're calling this match off, and he's like, right, he can't breathe. So I'm like, it's cool, I get back in and I finish the match, and I'm like this after the match, I'm like, I am really good, thanks. Pure struggling to talk. I'm like, that was good, I enjoyed it. It was still a good match at the end of the day, but it did hurt being stomped on the throat and feeling like there was like vomit coming up. It was stuck. It was a horrible feeling.
Oh, man. At least that one was in the ring. Yeah.
At least it was a show.
George Laurie, who I'm assuming is a relative of some description, he's just asked, would you rather wrestle The Rock in a title match or star in a movie with him?
Oh, I think you'd need to wrestle, wouldn't you? It would need to be a wrestling match, especially a title match, because if you're wrestling The Rock right now in a title match, it's going to be at WrestleMania. It has to be. So I'd wrestle. I'd wrestle him in a match.
As someone who is not athletically gifted at all, I would go for a movie. Yeah. I'd be quite happy with that. Although he had a 3-second match, I think his last match was like a 3-second match against Rowan, so I could do that.
That could be my match, or I could have like a 3-second segment in the movie where I serve him a drink, do you know what I mean? I could give him his coffee, I could be a barista in the movie and give him a coffee, or I could have a 3-second match with him at WrestleMania.
Yeah, I think when you put it out like that, I would probably go match as well, because it's not that much of an effort, really. Right, my stupid questions I've got is, what's your favourite dinosaur?
My favourite dinosaur?
Yeah.
It's Stegosaurus.
Nice choice. Any particular reason? Or?
There is actually, I used to watch these like when I was young in school. I used to watch these videos on YouTube. They're called ASDF movies. I don't know if that's something you've ever heard of. It might just be a thing, right? But it was just stupid me drawing cartoons that somebody had put up on my YouTube. And me and my pals found them hilarious for some reason. But there's this one sort of scene in it where this guy's invented a time machine and he's like, I did it, my time machine works, and this foot just comes down. And it's just this dinosaur going, I am a stegosaurus. But you should crush this guy in his time machine. And I don't know. Every time I think of dinosaurs, that's the only thing I can think of is a stegosaurus.
Fair enough. Another one we ask is... another one we ask is, what would have been in a fight, two sheep or one cow?
I see, I get told about this. I get told about this question. I would say two sheep.
I'm on board with that. I had a recent chat. My last chat interview I did was with Joe Hendry, and he gave me a telling off because I gave him insufficient information. Because he was saying, and I said, well, some people go two rams. He went, oh, no. You didn't say that. You said two sheep. So
I would still go with the two sheep.
I'm just going by numbers. I mean, a cow's solid and all, but it's two sheep.
Sheep are faster than cows as well. Sheep are faster than cows. Imagine two sheep running around you.
Exactly.
You can't keep up with them both.
It's one of those questions that I find that if you don't know the answer straight away, it's the answer you'll think of later and go, could have been that. But yeah, it's...
I will be lying then later and go, oh no, hold on, the cow might win.
Well, now I've asked... Now I've asked Rosie and Angel, you can all discuss it at length, what your answers were.
It will come out in an argument. You say discussion, we'll end up arguing about who would win a fight, two sheep or a cow. Do you know what I mean?
And you can thank Luke King Sharp for... No, it was actually... I think Craiger asked it. So you can thank Craiger for that, because he asked it for Lou's podcast, and I thought, I'm keeping it, because Lou got so raised by it, because it's like, I don't know the answer. I just go with whatever the opposite Craiger says now. So, plans to the future then, other than wrestling in front of, I wish I actually look up the number, 30 million people on Peacock. Again, not to add any pressure when you do the tapings. You're signed up to appear at Pro 2 Wrestling as well. What's your immediate plans with the show's return? Your goals?
Honestly, it's just, all I want to do is wrestle as much as possible. Like, if shows come back and I've only got 6 months to wrestle before everything gets shut down again, which wouldn't surprise me at all, I want to wrestle every single weekend in those 6 months. I just want to be wherever I can in those 6 months, or hopefully it's not just 6 months, like, touch wood and everything. Hopefully this is the end of it, and I wrestling in front of crowds is just normalised again, because It's not the same feeling going in there and not having a crowd there. Or after the show where there's still guys kicking about, wanting to have a chat with you, wanting pictures, autographs, whatever. It's not the same feeling. Honestly, it's fans make wrestling, I think. It's just a different... It's not a nice feeling knowing that they're still not in, or even when they're all back in, it's going to be limited numbers. So knowing that some people aren't going to get to actually see the wrestling, but as long as there's fans at some point, then that's my main goal right now, is just to be in front of fans constantly. That's the way I've always seen it from the start of these tapings. I just want to be in front of crowds. Like, obviously, I want to experience an ICW crowd now, but I've experienced all these family-friendly crowds and that. I've never got to experience an ICW crowd because I've been brought in during these tapings. So I'm excited to see what they bring.
Okay. You couldn't do any of the clapping and that to get a crowd going, but by now you're actually probably missing just doing the whole come on, clap.
Aye, definitely, honestly.
So let's say the shows are back, full crowds again, choice of opponents, who's on your shortlist, whether it's dream opponents, fancy, or just immediate people that you want to face again?
Always a fantasy opponent for me has been Edge, but it's just because he's a guy that got me in wrestling, so that's a fantasy opponent for me. Guys that are more realistic to wrestle, guys like I'd love to wrestle Leighton Buzzard again. I always enjoy wrestling Leighton Buzzard. Lou and Krieger again, guys like that, guys like Stevie Xavier. I've never got to wrestle Stevie Xavier. So I just honestly, like, whoever I can wrestle, I'd love to wrestle Jack Jester again. I'd like to wrestle him in ICW, I'll be honest, straight out there. I wrestled him in, obviously, in Labatt, in front of the family shows, but I know he plays a sort of different character in front of ICW crowds, so I think I would enjoy that as well. But absolutely, just honestly, anybody that sort of is there and I'm paired up to wrestle, I'm going to enjoy it either way. So.
And the same with promotions. Of course, as I've said, you're already signed up to appear at a Pro 2 wrestling show, but is there anywhere, any promotions that you haven't been to yet that you want to get to?
Again, it's just anywhere, really. Anywhere at all. Like, there's some promotions that I was due to work for before COVID hit, that hopefully that I still get the opportunity to work for, like PWI. I didn't get to work for them. I was due to work for them and everything. I broke my leg and then I was due to work for them and then COVID hit. So I'd like to work for PWI. Obviously, I've got Pro 2 coming up, which is exciting for me because I've never wrestled in Ayrshire, where they're basing. So I honestly, just anywhere that's willing to have me wrestle on their shows, I'm willing to be on their shows, you know what I mean? And I'll enjoy absolutely going anywhere.
Great. Well, I think that's pretty much, I've taken up enough of your time today, but I think from your story, it really is kind of just, and not to put like a big movie title on it, but it's pretty much just not giving up, because you've gone in, set back, gone in, set back, and then you went back in and then everything shut. So I'm not saying that you're cursed, but hopefully you get a good run once.
I finally went a year without getting injured. So I marked that the other day. I marked that this is quite possible the first year I've went without being injured in wrestling. Touch wood again, but I've probably just jinxed myself on that.
And I was speaking to Rosie. She was like, "Oh, she broke her ankle," and then COVID hit, and I was like, "Oh, it was your fault then," because. So, thanks for taking the time to speak to me. Where can people find you on social media?
On Twitter, I always get these confused, right? I think on Twitter I'm UK Logan Smith, and on Instagram I'm Logan Smith _ UK.
Other way around.
Ah, there you go.
So Logan Smith_ UK on Twitter.
I need to start writing again with the MC thing. I need to write it up in my hand. I need to write it up in my hand. I don't sweat it off during the interview.
Perfect. But yeah, thanks again for speaking to me today. And like I said, fingers crossed, next time I do get a chance to speak to you, let it be at a show, or it'll be wrestling will be back and you'll have like a belt or something to show off.
Aye. Anyway, hopefully. One can only hope.